Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the State Library. Thank you for agreeing to join us this afternoon for what we hope will be an inspired panel with some of our artists. Thank you to the State Library of New South Wales for partnering with us to host the exhibition Under the Sun that I hope you've all had an opportunity to go upstairs and see. Without partners like the State Library, it would be very difficult for us to host these programs while we're in a state of flux with our spaces, but we have a new pop-up space opening at 72 Oxford Street in mid-March, so do look out for us when we reopen that space. I'd like to thank all of the artists for working with us to participate in the Under the Sun exhibition, and particularly for the three artists that you'll hear from in a moment today. I'd also like to thank, in particular, our very small team at the ACP, and today Antoinette Clements, who's hiding up the back, who puts together our inspired public programs. For all of you that are here, and before I hand over to Daniel to chair the panel, I'd like to remind you all that we've got a pretty exciting event happening at 4 o'clock this afternoon. We've got the relaunch of Photofile. So issue number 98 comes back with a bang and is inspired by the Under the Sun exhibition, and we've got a great big focus on each of the artists in that show. So I would like to thank you all for coming and supporting the ACP. Please come and see us, or the show that we've got at Customs House at the moment, which is by the work of Atong Atem, also curated by Claire. But I hope you enjoyed today's panel, and I'd like to invite Daniel and the panel to come up onto the stage.
Thanks very much. Thanks for coming today and joining us for this discussion. I think we have about 40 minutes or so, is that right? 45 minutes or so. So maybe, Antoinette, you can give me a shout when we're getting towards the end or something. Throw something at me. So quickly, just to introduce the panel, or maybe we can introduce ourselves. So I'm Daniel Boetker-Smith, and I'm the new editor of Photofile, which is a really nice thing to be able to say. So maybe you can go down and introduce yourselves very quickly, and then we'll start with some curly questions, as Sarah described them.
I'm Sara Oscar.
I'm Claire Monneraye, the curator at the Australian Centre for Photography.
Right? Oh. Is that working? Nasim Nasr, one of the artists in this project.
Okay, thanks. Okay, so what we'll do is we might start with Claire, the curator, just to talk. Okay. And we might start with Claire, really, just to talk a little bit about the show upstairs. I'm sure you've all seen it briefly, and you'll have plenty of time to go back and have a look after today's session. But I guess really just thinking about the starting points, the curatorial agenda for the show, and I guess thinking about the Dupain picture and the sort of complexity of that picture in terms of its sort of physical history, in terms of, I think, first being shown in 1975 at the ACP, and then various, you know, in sort of reading about it and in reading your text, various accounts of it sort of not appearing for a long time after it was made and then disappearing and all those sorts of interesting things. So I guess the question would be around the idea of the collective sort of consciousness that it sort of became part of in the 70s and from then on, I guess.
Yeah, it is such a fascinating images, the Sunbaker by Max Dupain. And it's, I guess, what really fascinates me in that image is all the conversation that it kind of embraces and encapsulates, and that really complex history, as you said. So it is believed that the Sunbaker was shot by Dupain in 1937. Now, there's been a lot of conversation around the actual time when the Sunbaker was taken. Some art historian, photographic historian, have argued that it might have been taken a little bit later than 1937, and actually Sean Liking, who is the senior curator at the National Gallery of Australia, recently did new research and is now really, really confident to say that the image was actually taken in 1938. So, you know, it might sound a little bit not that important, but what's really interesting is, so it was shot during the interwar period. And as you said, Daniel, the image didn't really appear before the 70s. In fact, it was shown for the first time, like it appeared in print for the first time in 1948 in a publication, the first monograph that was published by Urey Smith. So Urey Smith was this absolutely fantastic art patron and editor in Sydney, and really, really supportive of Max Dupain. So he published the first monograph, and that's where the Sunbaker appeared for the first time. Now, to add a layer of complexity, the image that actually appeared in that monograph wasn't the Sunbaker that we all know. It was a different version of the Sunbaker. And it you know, really similar, but just slightly different framing, slightly different viewpoint. So it was just like shot had a different angle, which kind of gave to the image a more anecdotal or incidental feel. The image, the Sunbaker that we know, has a more like abstract and monumental feel to it. So the Sunbaker that we know appeared for the first time in 1975 on the occasion of the first retrospective exhibition dedicated to Dupain, and that was organized by the Australian Center for Photography. And Graham Oh, who was the director at the time, asked Dupain to use this image for the promotional poster of the exhibition. And Max was really, really keen to use the other version that was shown in the book, the 1948 book. But it happened that he lost the negative. So the only negative that he had, that, you know, was remaining, was that other version. And that's, so in the 70s, indeed, that this other version became really, really prominent. So first shown at ACP, and then, you know, I think what's really interesting is we have to remind ourselves how the 70s were such a crucial period of time for photography in Australia. Well, actually, not only in Australia, internationally as well. Well, it was very much a time where photography was started to establish itself as an art form and gain recognition from the institutional sector. And I think in many ways, you know, the work of curator like Gail Newton, who was in the 70s, 80s, the curator for photography at the Art Gallery of New South Wales, her research and her support to the to photography really contributed to established photography as an art form. And there were, she was crucial in establishing, I guess, you know, Max Dupain career, doing all this research. And she had a significant role in, I guess, in the writing of the history of that image as well, and making it so prominent. And, you know, and we're only in the 70s, but I guess that's very much the starting point where that image started to embody a certain idea of Australia, and you know, very importantly, an iconic image also for the history of Australian photography. It was a prime example of modernist photography in Australia for all. You know, the many, when you look at the image, the formal and aesthetics quality, again, the framing, that really, really unique angle, yeah, contributed to make that image such an icon in the 70s.
You know, and I think, I guess the next part of that, which I would like just to talk about very briefly, is that before we go into some questions for the other panelists, is that there was, I guess, the significance of the image and this quote that I read that Dupain said towards the end of his career, and he said something like, "I'm not sure about the picture. I think it's taken on too much. It was a very simple affair," he said. And I think there's something interesting about that in terms of the exhibition, because there is a political social, sort of political sort of statement, you know, in terms of who you've chosen to be part of the exhibition, who you've asked to make work, the way that the work that's been produced out of that as well. I think there's something quite political and quite reflective, if you like, on the sort of importance of the image. And I guess in terms of, you know, I love this idea of someone describing a photograph of a simple affair, which, you know, if you like photography, we all know that that's not true.
That's right.
But both is and isn't true at the same time, I guess.
Yeah.
And so I guess maybe just talking a bit about that sort of, you know, the white European viewpoint of Australia and culture and what that represents and how, in a way, the complexity of that you've started to deal with in the show, I think, I mean, with the artists that are here, but also in terms of the
team. Yeah. And you know, I think that's what very much interests me and fascinates me in looking at photograph. And it was a simple affair, this image. It was like the most simple photograph you could take and that we all have taken in a way. So it was on a camping trip with friends, and it was just, you know, snapping away his friends on the beach. And in fact, we're showing the negative of the Sunbaker in the space that is part of the collection of the State Library of New South Wales. And if you look really closely at the negative, there's one little detail that you can see on the bottom edge of the frame, which is the camera strap of Dupain, which kind of reminds you that it was, you know, really, really simple. What's fascinating, though, is all the meaning we have kept projecting on that image. And I think that's a great power of some photograph where that kind of allow those many, many, many interpretations and readings that kind of, you know, somehow go beyond the photographer own interpretation. And in fact, in 1991, he said to Helen Innes in an interview, it's quite funny, I'm actually using that to start the curatorial essay in the publication that will very, 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 very soon see the light. He said, "Ah, that bloody Sunbaker, here it is again." And you know, what's fascinating is it kind of didn't control that, the fact that people would keep reading and reading things onto the image. So, you know, it was, as I was saying, like shots in the interwar period and very much, I guess, symbolic of the ideas that prevail at the time, especially idea of vitalism and eugenism, which, you know, were really just really common, the kind of celebration of the healthy body of the male, you know, white male body. And it kind of went disappear a little bit, but it's still very much ingrained in that image as part of its history. And then every kind of decade, the way we're all kind of looking at that image is just adding layers and layers of interpretation. And you know, some people have seen Uluru in the shape of the shoulder of the Sunbaker. So I guess, you know, what I was interested with this exhibition was to kind of deconstruct or, you know, invite artists that have such a diverse practice, diverse backgrounds, to kind of deconstruct all the themes ingrained in that image and propose their own interpretation of it in today's context. So there's 15 artists, 10 of them are women, and 5 of them are male. Most of them are coming from multicultural or indigenous background. And it's right, it was a very, very deliberate curatorial choice to invite those different voices to, and I mean, we'll hear from the artists, but I guess I really invited them to look at the political aspect, and rather than restaging the image, which has been done, you know, in the 90s, and to really look at potential controversies and look at bringing different voices and how deconstruct that idea of representing collective and national identity.
Okay, great. So I think that leads us on nicely to hear from the artists. So what I guess what I'd do is I'd like to sort of go along the line and start with Nasim first, maybe. And I think just thinking about today, and I was thinking about, obviously today's the first time I've seen the work in situ as opposed to preparing it for the magazine on screen. And so I guess there was a few things that I was really sort of interested in terms of, I guess, the location of the image in terms of the beach and the sort of Australianness of that. And I guess how that connects with the title of the show about the sun. I think, you know, I was born in Australia but grew up in Ireland and England, and I think I always had this strange relationship with the Australian flag, because I always saw the Australian flag as being like a sort of a map for Europeans to get to Australia, because that's all it really is. It's just the Southern Cross, so it tells you where Australia is. So I always felt like the Australian flag was a very strange thing. It was like a map for me in Europe to tell me how to get back to the country, but it didn't really represent the country. And I remember seeing the Indigenous flag for the first time and feeling like, oh, that's what Australia looks like. And the Australian flag looks like how to get here, you know. And there was something, and I was thinking about that again the other day, thinking, you know, that sort of connects somehow, I don't know how, but it connects somehow to what we're talking about today in a way. But I guess thinking about that as an extension of that, this idea of the beach as being a place where that, you know, that's where arrival happens, if you like, as well. And so what I'd like to do really is to ask each of you just to sort of talk a little bit about the idea of the location of the picture and how maybe that influenced you and what your relationship with the beach is, for example. And also then what drew you to agree to be part of the show and to agree to respond to that picture particularly. Sorry, that was a long question, sorry.
I'll remember. Is this working?
Yes. Yep.
Firstly, I would like to thank you everyone for being here and making time on a Saturday at 2:30. Of course, you left your afternoon nap to be here. Thank you. And also thank you, Claire, for including me in this exhibition. So, and also ACP and Daniel for all the contributions to the whole, from the first moment to up till now. So thank you. Well, my connection to the beach was when I arrived in Australia in 2009. So I was an artist beforehand in Iran, and I was making painting and drawings, and I felt like there's not enough freedom of expression back home. So with my dad's decision, I decided to come to Australia. We all decided. So I came here, and in 2009, I landed, and the first place I went was beach. So to look at that beach culture from that moment, my whole art practice shifted from being a painter to a photographer and video artist. So I transformed, and the beach transformed me in many ways. So transformed my identity through my art. So that was a very big thing for me to start again in the new land in Australia with all the freedom I could have. So that was a major thing to start. So I started taking photographs of myself on the Muslim beach in South Australia, which is a nude beach, but I started covering up myself with a black cloth, which we wear in Middle East to cover ourselves as women. So, and that was, again, another direction to my practice. So standing on the beach back then, for me, was straight away talking about the cultural differences. We didn't have beach back home. I mean, we did have beach, but we didn't have a beach culture. So there was no nudity. There was no bathing on the beach. There was no family and male and female going on the beach and being able to freely explore that freedom of that, or meditate with the beach. But we had the bath culture back home. So we had that historical bath culture when women separately and men separately would go to these public places, which is inside. So we are in Middle East, we are very, people are not extrovert, we're very introvert. So from that moment, I was more inclined toward cultural differences and explore the whole dynamic of not having something, but had something else in the history that I can bring into my practice. So West and East became my main statement to make art. So basically, whatever I have made, I brought some elements from the history of Middle East to the new Western culture that I am a member of, and I'm proudly a citizen of this country. So to respond to beach culture for me, it was such special and moment when I was asked to be part of this, to respond to the beach with my perspective, with the limitations I experienced in the past, and how I can bring that together and how I can represent that amazing photograph of Sunbaker in a different form. Of course, I've been making videos and moving images since 2009, so video art would be the first thing I would do. And going to the location where Sunbaker, when Max Dupain took this photo, was straight away my first choice, even though I searched a lot about where to shoot this work. And my idea of beach and the location of north, south, east, west, and my knowledge being very extended by enormous support from the board members of ACP to collectors and to my wonderful supporters. Each one gave me a name of the beach to research, and I've learned so much. And at the end, I went back to where Max Dupain took the photo. So to respond directly to that, even though the photo talks and the video talks totally about different matters 80 years after what was happening. So the location, of course, was, I felt like I really like to be authentic about the location. The beach, of course, means so much to me, the freedom of beach. I mean, my husband all the time goes on the beach to meditate. He wouldn't go to gym or he wouldn't go to anywhere else. He just goes 1 hour a day on the beach to look at the water and meditates himself from the extremely busy life that he has. So I know that, and I felt it when I arrived, when I look at that waves coming toward me and go back, I felt like, why do I want to put my mat and sleep and take sun? I just want to spin around and release that energy of freedom. And I started to think about the idea of Sufi dance and another dance called Sama. Both dances are very, very traditionally recognized in Middle East. Sufi dance got roots in the Turkey, and then Sama, which means connection to the sky, and hearing the sound while you're connecting to the sky and movements. And Sama comes from Persian and Arab lands. So there's like I brought all of it to this dance. When they move their hairs, they spin around, and of course they are in front of the sea. So the whole meditating is happening. And wearing that fabric, of course, is one of those Turkish bath cloth when people dry themselves when they go to public bath in old Persia, if you like, not anymore in contemporary world, but in the old Persia and old Arab lands and old Turkish hammams, you would see this cloth being used a lot. Even I've received many emails last night from some audience that they said, we have one of them in our bath from the history, we just love to look at it, we don't use it, we got it in your video art, and it was so special to see it, that you use that fabric and you brought it back again to this contemporary world. So yeah, just combination of these two was really special for me to do. And I know that East and West are very different. In a way, they're a bit opposite, but they can complete each other and they can bring a harmony, which I've tried to do with my work a lot. I'm sorry, I talk a lot. If you just want to stop me, do please.
Great.
I can go forever.
Keep going. No, maybe we can pass on to Julie with the same question.
Well, I'll be very quick because I have to say my image has got nothing to do with the beach, really. And maybe that's because, you know, I'm several generations Australian. The beach is what we did every Sunday. So I think my studio is a big escape from the beach. I'm a studio-based artist. So I think my... I mean, I've got a connection to that image, which we all do have. It's just this iconic image. And I've also, I mean, I'll tell you a little anecdote. In 1982, I had my first exhibition, And it was all these photographs hanging from the ceiling. I won't go into all the details of it, but anyway, it was a complex configuration. And the story went out that Max Dupain visited the show and said, of course, this is not photography. And I was thrilled because I was trying to be an agent provocateur. And when we did a talk recently at something else about this work, I said, well, once again, he can say, this is not photography. So I guess I've always got this rather perverse relationship to the image. And I guess just one thing I was thinking about also, if you think about that image, I mean, I think a lot of photography, and obviously he took that image as Claire's saying, innocently, and I think something can be innocently conceived, but it's not innocently perceived. And I think that's an interesting thing about art, because I mean, I'm a fairly straightforward maker, I think. Like, Claire knows that the only thought I had about that work was I kept thinking, you know, the only way I could think about it was, how would I look at that image from underneath? That was my only thought about it, and I had some complicated way I was going to shoot that. And then luckily I went back to my casting ideas. But I've realised if you look at that work, it is like looking at it from underneath anyway. So I guess, I don't know if anyone's seen the show, but mine was just, it was like one of those clear thoughts. I just thought, right, do the pose. Then I thought almost immediately, how would I present that? And then the idea of the lectern came up. So I guess mine's subversive in a certain way, because it is making a comment about, you know, hiding your head in the sand, basically. And so I guess I've got strong thoughts about that in terms of how Australia relates to the rest of the world, and that, you know, we try to look like this carefree culture, or that's the kind of image we put out there and often how we're perceived. And I don't think that's true anymore, obviously, because we know our beaches are contested sites these days. So I guess in inviting people to take that pose, because that's why it's a negative form, and they're standing at a lectern, it's the opportunity to have your voice heard or to put your head down. And so, simple as my piece is, it wasn't simple to make. I tend to put a lot of effort into making, you know, casting bronze is quite a trip. And a casting place is about as far from the beach as you could get. It's hot in another way.
I guess it's interesting also that you, Claire, mentioned before that the negative is in the show, and I guess the only two negatives in the show are yours and Max Dupain's, really, which is sort of interesting.
Yeah, which is why, you know, I mean, I don't really regard myself as a photographer particularly. I know how to do it. But I think it's a very interesting medium to have conversations with, and with other mediums. So that's why I tend to often mix it up. I'm not devoted to any of them. I'm interested in ideas. And but, you know, it is interesting to go from photography to casting, because casting the body, I mean, there's a lot of ways to make sculptures. So casting from the human form, you do go through those negative processes just like you do with a photo. And I've always thought that's a sort of an interesting... And also you can reproduce from it. So you can make copies from it, you know. I can make lots of those images, by the way, if anyone wants to buy a lectern. But
see, yeah, Julie, so afterwards for
speak to me. But you know, so there is sort of, and I like obtuse connections. I think people, it's one of my criticisms, I have to say, of Australia, that often things, I mean, I'm a bit of a literalist, but I think that things can appear simple, but they can be very complex in what flows on from the reading, which is, I guess, what we're saying about the Sunbaker. Simple image, maybe, as I say, innocently conceived, but then it travels through time and people, you know, project other readings on it. So.
Yeah, no, I mean, I guess that's the history of the sort of photographic discourse, isn't it, that idea of, you know. But I guess there was one thing that you sort of said at the start about the idea of the beach not being necessarily important, but there was something in thinking about your work that I think I talked about in a couple of the notes that we sort of knocked back and forward, was that the idea of the beach as being a sort of private place, but also being a communal place. And I didn't, because I hadn't seen the work until today, and you know, we had this conversation, and I was like, well, you know, what is it? But you know, I got the feeling up there in the space that thing is both private and communal, because you're sort of having this private moment, but also everyone's standing around watching you too. You know, and it reminded me of
a person. That's a cast that's right. from somebody.
Yeah.
So exactly. you're, it's quite intimate if you think about it. You are touching, I mean, metaphorically, the skin of someone else. And it's also because it's a negative. Well, it, but also I've patinaed that part and left the rest of it. So it's also, colour comes into it too, you know. So I think it, I mean, I'm always happy if I make a work that's, it's bigger and better than I thought.
Are we all?
You know, because I do think some artworks just escape you and they free themselves from you. And that's really interesting. It's happened to me a few times when I make work that they kind of get a life of their own. So I don't know why Max would reject that happening to his image. You think he'd be quite pleased. Made him famous.
Okay, so let's move on to Sara. Thanks, Julie. I mean, I guess the same question really for you, Sara, in terms of, you know, what drew you to the project, but I guess also this idea of, I guess the idea of the beach and the idea of Australia, and I guess with your work, I guess there's elements there of, well, I'll let you talk about it. But I guess in terms of what drew you to the project in the first place, and I guess we can start with that.
Okay. This thing. Yep. Okay. I guess for me, the Max Dupain image represented a projection screen for cultural identity. And I thought about the position of the sunbather in, as having his face down in sand. And there's this sort of line where I take that as a sort of starting point for my work, that he lies face down in the sand. And it's a sort of a way of suggesting the idea of burying your head in the sand, but at the same time evoking certain images that have circulated in the media where that significance of lying face down in the sand has been taken to, you know, very serious and traumatic issues. I guess what drew me to the project in the first place was the idea of deconstructing this icon, you know, that has been constructed and deconstructed across time. And when you think about the circulation of the sunbather in the 1970s, it was really with the rise of beach culture as well, as an Australian thing, you know, and puberty blues and mambo. And yeah, so it fitted into a particular image of Australia that I thought was one that had this sort of mythical status, would be deconstructed.
I mean, obviously, you're referring particularly to, and in your, I think in your text as well, it talks about Aylan Kurdi, the boy that was on the beach. And I guess in talking about this idea of migration and things, and I guess that's the sort of underpinning, but I guess what I'd like to sort of hear about is, with your work, I guess more than anyone else's in the show, I think there's, and even in the way you've hung it, or the way that Claire and you have hung it, I guess, is that there is that sort of feeling of experimentation, is that feeling of trying things out, the way, you know, the way the images look, but also the way that they're sort of hung, there's multiple sort of connections that are sort of suggested, and it feels like it's very active on the wall somehow. So would you say that is that where would you say the project is at the moment? Is it still in the experimental stage, or do you think it's finished, or is it constantly sort of evolving? Or,
well, I think one thing I like about just putting a print on the wall is the sense of spontaneity that you get from, you know, not framing, just putting something up there. And in a way, look, I wanted it to sort of evoke a sort of archival sort of sense, because I am an archive artist. I do work with archives. All of this work came from historical archives, from the Australian War Memorial to the National Archives of Australia, to the State Library of Victoria and New South Wales. So in a way, this pinning and using a non-linear trajectory for hanging the work was all about evoking that. I mean, as for experimentation, you know, I think all art to some extent is experimentation. You know, that's what we do. I think what you're responding to is the sort of sense of spontaneity. Or that it is, you know, non-linear. Yeah, I mean, you know, maybe in Melbourne I'll hang it the opposite way.
No, I'm not saying it's wrong. I think I was interested, I guess, in this idea of also that, I guess, coming back to the idea of the sort of spontaneity or the experimental idea is that, I guess what I was interested in was the representation of trauma. If you think about Australian photography or Australian art, is that, you know, there's very, well, there's lots of work about trauma, but I guess in terms of the idea of the beach and trauma, they're not two things you would normally put together, I think, in a way. And I think the gap that you found sort of is an interesting way into that sort of juxtaposition of those two things. If you think, as we've spoken about the beach, with Nazim's work, it's a totally different sort of sensibility about what the beach represents. And with yours, it's sort of almost the other end of the spectrum somehow. I think that's kind of interesting.
No, well, I mean, trauma is about forgetting, really, and oblivion, you know, like it. And it's also something about repression as well. And, you know, we don't often think of the beach as a site of trauma because it's not a comfortable way of conceiving of a landscape ever, you know. I mean, if you think about landscape, the landscape of Australia, it is founded on trauma, really. So for me, the alignment between the beach as a space of leisure and kind of juxtaposing that with this other way of looking at it, you know, thinking about the beach as a space of imprisonment makes, you know, is kind of really significant for a lot of people, and, you know, and be that. Yeah.
Great, thanks. Claire, do you want to add anything else before I open up for questions?
Look, I think just hearing Sarah, what's really, I think a really important component of the work is that notion of ambiguity and that notion. And I think that's something we find actually in a lot of the work is the, I guess, dichotomy and that tension between hiding and revealing. And in many ways, I think that's what the exhibition is about, is that idea that we think we know that image so well, but the whole idea of the exhibition is very much around kind of revealing you know, some aspect of the work. And all the artists employ so many different creative gestures to do so. And the, I guess, richness of the exhibition is very much, you know, that diversity of the photographic medium. And I really, you know, I mean, Julie's gesture with her sculpture talks so much about what photography is today, in allowing us to reveal new meanings and create new new connection that might be really, really ambiguous, not necessarily linear or literal. But yeah, so there's a lot to taking conceptually and formally in the exhibition. But I think, it's great to have a space to do that.
On that, I think there's something about, particularly with Julie's work, you know, because there is so much about photography. There's very much this imprint, the death mask of Todd Robinson, you know, Harold Savage, in the pose of Harold Savage, that is about, and something that Julie said that it was not photography, you know, about exploring what the medium is too. Because, you know, and I feel that with my work, you know, you say that it's sort of experimental. I think the one thing that strikes me with a lot of the artists is pushing the boundaries of what the medium is, and thinking about...
Yeah, I was just going to say too, I mean, I felt we were offered this opportunity to respond to an iconic image. How we responded to it, what medium, didn't have to be photography. You know, I mean, we're responding... That's a weird thing about photography, though. It's also informational. So it's like something we can have a discussion about, and, you know, through all sorts of other mediums, because that's the role it mostly plays in the world, if you think about it. It's there to inform or misinform, as the case may be. So it's more a point of discussion than it is, you know, that you literally have to respond to it photographically. And I think this show is really interesting in that way, that people have found all sorts of angles on it. I mean, it's quite fascinating.
I mean, I think that's what happened with the sort of email that I sent to you about the work. When I read the title Speechless, I think I said I read it as an exclamation, like that you were outraged, like, I'm speechless, you know? And you sort of corrected me quite rightly. But
speechless with wonder, though.
Yes, exactly. So, and I think, and that's exactly what you're saying, is that, you know, that photography has that beautiful sort of ambiguity, and that notion of changing through time, but also changing through discussion. Hopefully, that the discussion we've had today, actually, people go back to the show and maybe see things slightly differently than they did before they, you know, sat down and listened to us rabbit on. So I guess, I don't know how we're doing for time. Okay. Okay. So I guess what we might do is. I saw a couple of hands go up. So what we might do is open the floor for some comments or questions. Do we have a microphone?
Is this working? Yeah, it is. Look, I mean, I think it's, to me, it's really interesting, and it's been pointed out that the photograph was taken in 37 and really rediscovered in 75. Now, if you look at it as a 37 print, and I discovered it as a 70, I think it's a 75 print. I think that's when Australians kind of saw it. I saw it as a piece of modernism in 1937. But what I think is also a kind of, which is what to me is also interesting about Dupain is he did a lot of personal photography, but most of his photography was architectural photography. And yet, when I say most, I mean, that's what he did. He was an architectural photographer most of his life. And yet, this will be the image that he's remembered for, as will some of the surrealistic nudes that he did, and so on and so forth. And there's more to it in that too, because... as I said to someone, he said, well, he had to kind of keep going. He had to have a working studio. And I think he loved doing the architectural photography, but his greatness may have been, his further greatness, when you look at the body of his work, if he'd continued in the vein that he'd done. And I think there is also some work where both Max and Rex look at busts, European busts as such, washed up on the beach. So it's kind of interesting that he went back and re-explored it too. I suppose what I'm saying is this photography to me is much more interesting, as fine as his architectural photography is.
Well, I think that's often... I mean, I used to run a photographic practice, photographing artworks. It's a job. You know, so you're using a skill to earn some money. So I'm not surprised. And it's the same as David Moore, who sort of followed him as known for his work in architecture and photography. So I guess it doesn't mean you don't make really interesting images just because you're doing it as a kind of client-based thing. But But if you think about it, his the position that he took that photo in is a bit like you'd take a skyscraper. You know, he's made the figure look much more monumental and sculptural.
And in fact, that second version, I mean, you can tell by looking at the... So the first version is also in the show you might have seen in the Van Dyck album, which is the only print that exists of that second version. And on the first version, you can see like drops, you know, droplet of water on the skin of the Sunbaker. And they're not, you know, they're on the well-known version, which really means that he actually staged. You know, he staged that as a version. And you're right, the low angle, like, I think Rex actually was, Rex Dupain was Max's son, explained that he certainly, like, dig a hole in front of Harold Selvage to kind of, you know, have that angle. So I think that's, you know, I think it was a lot of humor as well, where he was probably... undermining his, you know, his own work by saying that it was simple, but yet knowing that it was a great piece of art, and indeed, like, very much in the continuity of his architectural work, and yeah.
I think I was just thinking also, interestingly, you know, this idea of the time sort of gap between 37 and 75, I think there's something interesting about that if you think about the sort of European history of photography or the American history of photography or Japanese, where you have a reaction in the 60s and 70s to the photography of the 30s and 40s. I guess Dupain, well, this image sort of missed that out because it wasn't shown again until 75. I think people didn't really know about it before then, I guess not. I mean, so in a way there wasn't a reaction to it in the 60s and I guess in the 70s. And I guess that then gets into the whole sort of, you know, civil rights movement in Australia and what that was and who was at the forefront and those things, and whether the history would have been different if that image had become iconic straight away. You know, how, you know, in a way, how would that, you know, could that have sort of impacted on the discussions that were happening in the 60s? I don't know.
Yeah, I think that's incredibly complex and it's really hard to explain why it you know, became that prominent in the 70s. I think it's a mix of, I guess that's what I was trying to explain by, you know, suggesting how, you know, photography was going through such an important kind of, I guess there were a lot of political agenda in the 70s, where the photographic world was really looking at images to kind of establish itself, like, you know, find public support. And I mean, if you think about it, so the Australian Centre for Photography was founded in 1973 by the Australia Council for the Arts. The photographic department at the Art Gallery of New South Wales was established, you know, roughly in the same period of time. So there were this agenda of kind of retrospectively, in a way, finding photographer that proved the modernity of photography and to kind of write that history and prove to the general public that photography was, you know, worth being part of the biggest institution alongside painting and sculpture. And look, that's I think there's also in the 70s a really, really interesting conversation around the definition of Australian national identity. And of course, you know, there was a time where Gough Whitlam was the prime minister. And it was such a crucial period of time for Australia to kind of define itself and that notion of multiculturalism as well, that very much appeared, you know, roughly in the late, like mid-60s, late 60s. And I think that image just kind of emerged in that context and was that kind of perfect projection screen, actually, as Sarah was saying, for people to kind of project their own imagination and identify themselves to that figure. It's just really hard to trace. It's this kind of weird mix of psychological and political way we have to read and react to images. And, it, you know, that's in many ways what makes that image so iconic. It's not just about what the image is, but about that history and all those conversation. I mean, if you're interested in that, there's a lot of writing that have been, done around those conversation. And Jeffrey Batchen, Professor Jeffrey Batchen, wrote an absolutely fabulous essay on that really complex history, and especially speaking about how it was retrospectively in the 70s made, such an iconic image, where really in the 30s, it wasn't known. So you can actually, you can find it online really easily by Jeffrey Batchen. And so, kind of go to essay to read,
Julie, you look like you wanted to say something.
Now, I was sitting here thinking that given it was done in 1937, I mean, you wonder if it was shown then, it could have easily been perceived as this rather kind of fascist version of a body. I mean, think of people like Leni Riefenstahl and the
Mensch.
I mean, it's interesting when you think back then. I'm not suggesting he thought like that, but he may have been influenced by that kind of imagery that was coming out. It's like an idealization.
Wasn't his father a eugenicist?
His father was a really, really...
What did you say? His father was what?
His father into eugenics?
Yeah. I think that's really difficult. Is in the... Yeah, I mean, I think that's, again, like a retrospective reading as well, where, and it's kind of came up like in the 90s, where somehow we started to read Dupain work through that prism. But in fact, in the 30s, it wasn't labeled that way. I guess became that tainted after the Second World War and, what we know happened. But his father was very much involved in, physical culture, and he had, one of the most kind of fabulous gym in Sydney, and actually really avant-garde in terms of body and physical culture. So he was definitely influenced by that. But I wouldn't, label him as a... I think that's also a retrospective reading.
But I think what's interesting that's emerging in the conversation is this idea of the what ifs of around, because I think Australian photography it's sort of very bitty because it receives influences from so many different places, and that you have these movements that appear, but then they sort of stop and something else happens, and then so there's not a linearity to it that there is in, say, American photography or. But I'm not saying there should be, but I think there's something interesting about the Dupain picture sort of disappearing through those decades, and what, like Julie, what might have happened and what the reaction might have been, if you like. I think that's sort of interesting. I think there's one thing I want to come back to just with Sara for a second, which I think we didn't talk about enough, really, was, I guess, in terms of, I guess because I spent the most time with your work with the magazine, because there's an interview in the magazine with Sara and Claire, and so there's quite a few images of Sara's in there. And I guess I just wanted you to talk a little bit more about, because you've gone in a way beyond the borders of Australia to Nauru, which isn't Australia but sort of is now, I guess, or it's something. And I guess, could you talk a little bit about that, about why you sort of drew in those elements to it?
Yeah, so you've noticed that in the work there are two photographs, there are two architectural photographs in the work, and they're by Max Dupain. And the buildings are of Nauru House in Melbourne. And I guess I always think about...
How did that happen? How did you find them?
Building. It's sheer coincidence. Right. I was looking through Max Dupain's archive and archives of Nauru, and I came across this Max Dupain image in the Nauru archive, and kind of went, what? What the hell? Yeah. What's going on here? And I guess, the thing is this constant reminder of the Nauruan presence in Australia by that image, that building. I mean, it's no longer belongs to Nauru, but it did for a period of time. And you know, the topic of Nauru is so prevalent in the media and in the Australian psyche anyway. I think that it's so, for me, it didn't feel like too much of a stretch to go to the beach somewhere else. You know, like when I was making the work, I really wanted to go to Nauru and shoot the beach from exactly the same angle that Max Dupain shot Salvage from at Kalbarra. But I was unable to obtain a visa at that particular point in time. So, you know, I wanted to sort of think about that relationship in a way, you know. What does the beach mean from another space, another landscape?
No? What does the beach mean from the water too, which I think is really interesting. You know, when you're looking at, you know, if you think about, say, European arrival and then looking about, you know, think about refugees, I think there's something, there's so many metaphors, so many sort of beautiful sort of... okay, I think we have time for another question, if we have one. Someone over here?
Sandy?
Yeah, thanks for pointing that out, Sandy. It's, I guess, a little bit as I was mentioning Jeffrey Batchen, I guess what Sandy is referring to, Isabel Crombie, she wrote this incredible book, such a reference book in the history of Australian photography. It's titled Body Culture. And she's very, very, very much looking at that whole idea of Dupain relation with vitalism and eugenism, the pseudoscience of eugenism. And she really subtly and really cleverly explained how tricky that reading might be, but also how it is ingrained in Dupain's work, and especially with the Sunbaker. Thank you, Sandy.
Okay, I actually have a question for all of you very briefly. I think just thinking about the process that you've been through now and reflecting on what you've done, I guess, would you say that it has, what impact has it had on your practice? Has it changed your practice? Does it fit smoothly in the narrative of your career? Has it been something that was jolting and snapped you out of something and has taken you a different direction? How would you sort of, I mean, I know it's only just opened last night, so you haven't had time to reflect on it too much, but would you say that it has, what sort of impact has it had on your practice, do you would say?
It did have sort of impact on my work, because I normally shoot my videos in a studio, close to studio. Coming from the culture of closeness and inside, indoor, everything, I normally shoot my work inside and indoor, and I have done many videos in the studio space. So for me to go outside and drive 3 hours to get to the right location and to connect with the moment and the exact spot. So of course it was very something that went out of my comfort zone. And I enjoyed it. Also, incorporating Australian and Western models in my work was another direction that I didn't take in the past. But and how much they were flexible with the whole attaching themselves to this old historical Persian movements, it was fascinating. And I you know, I expected someone. I have a wonderful model and costume designer, Negar. She's sitting there. So she's originally a Turkish lady. So she connects with the work, and as you expect, with the fabric, with the movement, with everything. But to see other Australian and Western English models responded so beautifully to the work was something I was very impressed. And I thought, this is something I would like to continue. And the flexibility they gave me, the whole they were really into it more than anyone from the culture that I come from. And that was very, very interesting to experience. So that kind of was another... you would see, if you go through the survey of my work since 2009, this is a very, very different work. And of course, there's a narrative to it. So, and a narrative, a beginning, a middle, and an ending. So if you see the exhibition, you see all the models like very still on the beach, and then they would go to this performance and movement of this dance, and then go back to the Sunbaker position. And that's how it ends. So that was another thing that I normally don't have narrative for my work, and I really wanted to make that happen, just the way we look at the world and the way we live in this world of day and night. We wake up, we go through the day, and we go back to sleep, and so on. The life and death, the whole, everything, you know, it was like telling that, going through that again with this video. So there was like a few changes and few things that stretched my comfort zone and in a positive way. So I really felt it with this work, as you would see in the gallery, and I hope you all have seen it or you would see. So
great, thanks.
Well, I guess for many, many, many years, and maybe earlier in my practice, I used a lot of European works. I think probably the first time I've ever responded to an Australian work. I don't see a great big history of continuing doing that. But what I was thinking is it's always interesting if you are using something didactically like that as a trigger, whether the work, like I'd like to show that work again in a few years in another context and see, does the Dupain shadow hang over it? I hope not. You know, and it's interesting because we're all in this specific show. You know, it's like reimagining Max Dupain's Sunbaker, but I imagine we will have our own practices. So,
life that work will take on of its own after the. Interesting, yeah. Yeah, thank
you. You know, it's funny that you should ask that question because when I was making this work, and like Julie, I was thinking, you know, and the litmus test for me was actually, does this work have the capacity to hang on its own outside of the context of the show? And that was, a pretty cool point for me. I mean, it's not really too far outside of the realm of what I do, you know. I guess the only difference is that in this work there probably are no props. You know, there's no sculpture, all kind of performative element.
I guess that's where the sort of bravery of not only you guys to agree to be part of it, but also for Claire to sort of propose such a ridiculous idea. Because I think, you know, in a great idea, because I think it's so tenuous, you know, in a way. It could, like Sara said, I think I would have responded the same if someone had asked me. I would have thought, well, this could just be an illustrative sort of project that would go nowhere. But I think all the work is so strong, and I think that's a very... I'm complimenting you, that's what I'm saying. Brave thing to sort of put out there, because as Julie said, you sort of said, and as you told me many times, I've just said to the artist, whatever you want, guys, it's up to you. You know, so I think that's, you know, to be applauded, I think.
And I think all the work in the show have the... you know, will have the capacity to just stand on their own. And I mean, of course, they're, you know, the Sunbaker was a trigger for all of them, but they go so far beyond the Sunbaker. They're all, you know, some of them are so personal to the artist. Some of them have, you know, such an incredible political controversy and depth to them. They all have a lot more than the Sunbaker to them. So, I think it was, you know, obviously I did, you know, didn't think about it, whether there was a ridiculous idea. But yeah, obviously the risk was to be literal, which wouldn't add anything to the conversation. But I think we're heading a lot. to that conversation by not being literal.
One thing I wanted to point out was we're all responding to the image from 80 years ago, and what would be the image that 80 years after today possibly people would respond to? And that was my question when this exhibition started, because that could be a very good question to finish the whole this show with, like what would be any type of art or from a painting or an image or photographic or a sculpture, and what do we call photography now? And yeah, on how would all of these works stay on long term and how this would be seen again? So
let's reconvene in 80 years.
Say there's nothing new under the sun.
So if there's no more questions, anyone dying to get something off their chest before we finish? No? Okay, so thank you very much to our panellists for their time and being very generous with their descriptions of their work and their process, and to Claire for telling us all about your curatorial process. I meant ridiculous in a positive way. Aspirational, maybe I should have said. So at 4 p.m. today, in here, we will be launching the new edition of issue of Photofile. So please join us then, which is very soon. And I'll be talking again, but not for very long. So round of applause for our panel, please. Class dismissed.